Not what we live is life to outside forces, to fate, everything. You want to be in control of your life. What you want to see is what you want to see. You must guide your soul. You must make sure that the seed that is sown in your soul is the seed of the fruit that you want to see. When God made man, he made man as Lord over his heart. And he makes man to control the mind. Now, pardon me if I use mind, heart interchangeably. To me, they mean the same thing. They are two sides of the same coin. It has to do with consciousness. Just like you can. So if I say I love my wife with all my soul, and indeed I do. Or if I say I love my wife with my heart, and I do. It means the same thing. It means I am conscious of my affection for her. So it means the same thing. Okay? So if I say heart or mind, I mean the same thing. So every man is Lord over his own soul. Therefore, you must mind your thought. You must mind your thought. You must check your thought always. And whatever you are thinking that does not align with what you want to see, uproot it. How do you uproot it? Make declaration. If inside your heart something is saying you can't make it, immediately open your mouth and say, I will make it. Just like the declaration that Dr. Albert said. Immediately. Please, don't let it go. If a thought just comes to you, sometimes you just like, oh, something happens to you and you are thinking, have I not said this thing before? You didn't say it before. It was your thought. And it came to pass. And you are wondering, did I dream about this? It seems as if I said this in a dream. It's a powerful thought. Immediately confess. I said, no. Romans 10:10. By the heart, man believes unto salvation. And by confession, you have to confess it. Now, how do you guide your heart and make sure that the right seed is planted? Number one, do not think of obstacles to be what they are not. Obstacles are part of life. They have been from the beginning and they will be forevermore. You know why? Look at Genesis 1:28. Look at what God says. 1:28. Then God blessed man, blessed you. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply. And fill the earth and do what? If you want to be fruitful and you want to multiply, you must be ready to subdue. If you are not ready to subdue, you cannot be fruitful and multiply. It's not possible. So one of the things that you have to do with your heart is that you believe that you can subdue any mountain, that you can scale any wall. By the way, I didn't tell you, the slogan for the Impact Conference is scaling walls. That is the slogan. So if I say Impact Conference, you reply, scaling walls. Yeah, because that was what we are meant to be. That is our vision. We can scale any wall, any obstacle, no matter what it is. So in your mind, you don't think of obstacles and being the end. No, you are wired to be able to subdue. You have that power because he already blessed you. Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth. Subdue is a commandment. He said, come, let us make mine an image. Let them have dominion. So he has given you that dominion. Brethren, you have that power to subdue. Obstacles are not powerful as they say. Obstacles may be loud. If they look big, they may appear insurmountable. But by the word of God, no, they are not. You have power. After all, you say this. The power that is within me is what? Greater than. That is what he's saying about. That's what he's talking. So So you have to believe that in your heart that I have a power within me. It's according to the power that works inside of me. That is how God works. God works according to the power that works in you. And that power, number one, is the power of thought. Do you believe I can do this? Do you think this is possible? Oh yes, Lord. Okay, in that case, let's go. Have faith in God and have faith in yourself. Jesus Christ will say, let it be done unto you according to your faith. Which means, have your faith in yourself. Peter said to Jesus, if it be you, bid him come. And Jesus Christ said, come. And in his heart, he believed. And started walking. And all of a sudden, the physical eye saw the wind. And he doubted. And it went down. So it is according to the power that works inside of you. Let me tell you another true life story to explain what I mean. First book of Samuel chapter 17. There was a man called Goliath. Everybody was looking at Goliath. And they saw a man huge. They saw a man, they called him, they said he was a champion. And David came, and David said, you know the first thing that David, you know I said he can be loud. The scripture says every time Goliath will come and rant, and the people will be afraid, including Saul the king, they will run away. Obstacles will always be loud. They will always look big. But only you, if you believe, run towards it. The scripture says that David ran towards Goliath. I told you about the eye job. Once my heart goes over it, I will run towards it. And I will lift my body so that my body can go over it. The higher the bar becomes, the higher my heart goes and my body follows. So obstacles should be taken for what they are. If anything whatsoever, they're opportunities. So everybody who are afraid, they are dismayed. Guess what David asked them? What would be given to the man that removed this liar? They were looking at difficulties. He was looking at opportunities.
He was
looking at the reward. They were looking at the weight of the body. David was looking at the head. Once I remove the head, the body is nonsense. In which case, everyone else was looking at the enormity of the problem. But David knew, all I need to do, remove the cause. This is what is causing it. Remove the edge. Once you remove the edge, forget about every other thing. That's all. You are done. That is what obstacle is. Obstacle is to promote you. It's not to bring you down. 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 46. David said, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hands. And I will strike you and take off your head. That's all I need to do. Nothing else. I'm not bothered about your body. Forget about it. Number three. Always think about abundance. Never think of lack. Never think of lack. You've heard about the proverbial glass that has water. Some look at it and say it's half full. Some say it's half empty. Don't look at that glass as half empty. What it does when you look at the glass as half empty is it draws power from you. It takes away from the power that's supposed to work within you. Because it discourages you. You'll be thinking, oh, it's half full. I'm sorry, it's half empty. Very soon it will be empty. Where am I going to have the next supply? So instead of looking at how God will use you or somebody to bless you, you'll be thinking, soon it will be done. So don't look at any situation. Don't look at the glass and say, oh, but look at it as half full. When you look at the glass as half full, you know what it does? It picks up the power within you because it gives you hope. Because then you believe, at least I still have a fool. Who knows? Something can happen tomorrow. God can do something about it. So I still have hope. I rejoice. That is what it does when you look at it as half full rather than half empty. Let me quickly explain this. Let me use another true life story. These are true life stories recorded for us. 1 Kings chapter 17 from verse 8. From verse 1 to 3, God called Elijah. He said, Elijah, come. I have prepared. No, he said, prepared. He said, I have commanded a woman, a widow, to feed you. Verse 9. He says, arise, go to Zarephath. We belong to Sidon and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you.
No.
How did I find out that indeed God commanded a woman? Because the scripture says, next verse. 10. Says, so he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate, indeed, as God said, a widow was there. So how did God command the woman? The woman had nothing. And God said, I've commanded her. Did God speak to her? Let's find out. So, verse 9 says, just note that. Verse 9. Say, see, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Then, verse 10. Indeed, the widow was there. Again, 6. Now, when Elijah got to this woman, Elijah called her and said, please. No. He said that when he went there, the woman was there, and he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. He first told her a simple thing. If it's water, you get water. It was good. Then he called her back. Next verse, 11. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, and please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. And the woman said, what? I do not have bread. It is true, she did not have bread. It was not bread. She had flour and she had oil. And he said, okay, go and make it to bread. And Elijah told her something. Do not be afraid. Power of thought. Because once she becomes afraid, then the miracle will not work. Do not fear, but go and do as you have said. And the scripture says what? And the woman went. What does that mean? Verse 15. Verse 15. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. What does that happen? What does that mean? It means that she changed her thought. You remember previously when she first met Elijah, what she said was, I have no bread. I only have this flour and this small oil, and I'm going to prepare it for myself and my son, and we eat and we die, and that's all. But by the time Elijah told her, I think your problem is fear. Don't fear. You have hope. And the woman believed because she went and did it according to, and of course we know what happened thereafter. That he lived thereafter. There was no lack, there was nothing. So don't you ever look at lack. Focus on abundance. You have $1,000 in your account. What about the man that has $10 million debt? You want to change? You are still in credit. You have hope. Now, number 4. Always look for the opposite in every situation and choose the word you want to live with. In every situation, I tell you, there's always opposite. Good, bad, life, dead, evil, good, money, after anything whatsoever, there's always opposite. Look at that situation and choose one. Whatever the situation is, there will always be good in it and there will be bad in it. All you need to do is to look at the good, and that is what you do. In the book of Numbers, chapter 13, Moses sent 12 spies. He says, go to the land and go and spy the land. Go and spy the land. Numbers verse 17. It says, then Moses sent them to spy out the land and said to them. As a matter of fact, I believe earlier in verse 1, Moses already told them. Let's see verse 1. He said, go and spy, tell them, and God spoke to Moses, verse 2, to go and spy the land. I am willing. Send them to spy out the land which I'm giving to them. I'm giving it to them. Let them go and spy. But then the spies went. And this is what Moses told them to do. Verse 18. Always good opposite. That's always opposite. He said, go and see what the land is like. Whether the people who dwell there are strong or they are weak. Whether they are few or they are many. 19. Whether the land they dwell in is good or is bad. Whether the cities they inhabit are like camps or strongholds. Next one. Whether the land is rich or is poor. Whether there are forests there or not. But be of good courage. Which means choose the one you like. But I'm telling you, choose the one that is good. Because it added, and bring some fruit of the land. Because now at this time that I'm sending you is the season of harvest, the season of the first ripe grapes. And 10 of them, look at the opposite. Good, bad, strong, weak, bad. I think we better have to choose bad. Let us choose weak. We are like grasshoppers. And they chose that and they came back. But Caleb and Joshua said, No. Look at verse 23. That is funny. Verse 23. And they came, and there cut down a branch of one cluster grapes, and they carried it all the long. And they brought it to the people just to show that the land is good. But they decided to say that they were grasshoppers. And they did not get to the promised land. Only Caleb and Joshua got there. Quickly, next one. Don't play blame game. It takes away power from you. It takes away power from you and put it to someone else. The power is supposed to be within you. You should have control over your life. Whatever happens to you, take responsibility for it. You know why? Because when you take responsibility for it, what you then do is to look at different ways of doing it. You start to think, what can I do to make it better? What else can I do next time so that I do not fail? But when you start saying, oh, if not, because of my accent. If not because I'm a black man. If not this, you are looking for the solution outside of you. Which means you are giving the power which God gave you to them to control. So anytime anything happens, it's him, it's my wife. Ah, thank you. That reminds me of our daddy. Adam. God went to him. Adam, where are you? Said, I heard your voice and I was naked, so I hid myself. God said, who told you that? Who told you? How did you know? Did I give that information? Did you ever know that you are naked? Did it ever cross your mind? Was it in your heart that you are naked? No. So who told you? Somebody outside of you gave you the information and you believe. And you give your power to him. Instead of him saying, Lord, I'm sorry. Repent. Change the way you think. Don't blame somebody outside of you. Do not blame Eve. Don't blame your wife. No. If I had married a white woman, if I had married a Canadian,
I not have brought him from Igbo land. Don't. Take responsibility. You have the power to turn the situation around. Have faith in God and have faith in yourself. You can do it. Six. Do not give away your power to information. We have lots of information now. When I first came to this country, oh, I love the country in which I was born. Do I still have time? I think so. Okay. I used to go to the internet and go to www.guardiannews.com. I've been reading about Nigeria. I was hopeful that things would change. But each time I read news, I became depressed. Things were becoming worse and worse. So I made up my mind after, I think, 1 or 2 years. Never again. Up to today, 16 years ago. No news about Nigeria. When they discuss APP, progress, or they change now. PDP, power. It's not my business. I don't want anybody to hurt my heart. I don't listen to cable boss. The day I look at it, I just open CNN. Jeez, I think last week, okay, it's been a while, watch CNN, watch. And I saw this news. There was a lady, a young lady, how old was she? 18, 21 or so, that he met a man at the bar. And they got talking within 1 month, I think September. And she allowed the man into our house. Before you knew what happened, he killed her. Oh no, I was bothered for days. I said never again. So don't allow external information to distort what you believe. That was what happened to the children of Israel, 20 years and above. They believed the 10 spies. They did not believe Caleb and Joshua. And so they all died and perished in the wilderness because they gave their power out to external information. Lastly, mind the company that you keep. Because the company that you keep will definitely affect your thought process. It's either it makes you wise or it makes you stupid. Proverbs chapter 13:20. He who walks with the wise will be wise, but the companion of fools will be destroyed. In fact, there's a research that was done. This research says you are average of 5 of your closest friends. The average. 5 of your closest friends. So you become like them. So do not remain in the company of people just because you enjoy their company. If there's nothing you learn from them, if there's nothing they do to change your life or the way you think, disconnect. Don't say, I'm comfortable here. Leave the faith zone for faith zone. Faith, F-A-T. Leave the faith. Don't say, this is my faith. Leave it for your faith, F-A-I-T, your faith zone. That was what Moses did. Faith brought Moses to the palace. Remember, the daughter of Pharaoh saw him, brought him from Egypt, and he grew up. And the scripture says he was learned in the literature of Egypt. He was taught, very well taught in the palace. But after a time, he knew that he did not belong to the palace. So he led the faith zone to the faith zone. Say, this is where I believe. If he had remained in the palace, you know what would have happened? He would have lived outside the plan of God for his life. Nobody would have remembered him. Nobody would have spoken about Moses. Amen.
Amen.
And now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond that which we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Dunamis, the power within for the man in you. God bless you.
Hallelujah.